Sunday marks the deadline for enrolling in the state and federal health exchanges this year. The push is on once again to get people to sign up. There are signs that perhaps more than 10 million will enroll, fewer than initially expected, but better than a revised estimate showed. To fill us in on the latest, we are joined again by Mary Agnes Carey of Kaiser Health News and Susan Dentzer. She's a health analyst for the NewsHour, and it's good to see you both again.
Great to be here.
Time to talk health care. So, Mary Agnes, just overall, how's the process been going the second year?
Well, the website's a lot better. It actually works. And that's better for everyone trying to enroll. And the federal government said that right now we've got about 10 million people who have enrolled in picked a plan. Most of those people, about 7.75 million, are with the federal exchanges. That's in about 37 states, and the rest are from the state-run exchanges.
So how many of these who are signing up, how many of them are people who are returning, who were part of the system last year, and how many are new?
About 42% of those individuals are new enrollees, and about 58% are re-enrolled. But what we don't know about that 58% that's important, did they actively re-enroll in their plan, or did they pick a new plan? And that's important because if you didn't go back and evaluate the price of the plan, the subsidy, and how much it could buy, you could end up with a subsidy that buys less. You could end up in a plan that costs you more or costs you less if you were automatically re-enrolled and didn't evaluate that for yourself.
So those are all factors that are being watched.
Absolutely. We'll know more about it later in the year.
So, Susan, as we were just saying, the administration has, the expectation number has shifted. It was 10 million, then it was lowered, but now it looks like it's going to be better than that. What's going on?
Well, it is in fact the case that the administration was expecting a maximum of 9.9 million to enroll in this open enrollment period, and it looks like we overshot that. It looks like it is higher than 10 million. That's still lower than what others had estimated, including the Congressional Budget Office, which was estimating 12 million enrollees. But it looks like we'll probably come in about in the middle, 10, 11 million people.
Why do they think it isn't higher? Are they pinpointing what the challenges still are out there?
Well, for one thing, it's hard to get people who haven't already had coverage to sign up. We know that that's the case. We also know that the Congressional Budget Office, for example, was expecting more employers to drop coverage and send their workers to exchanges, and that hasn't happened. Employers have actually stuck with their coverage. So that accounts for the Congressional Budget Office lowering its estimates about how many people would actually buy coverage through the exchanges.
And I know you've been looking at gender as well. You're seeing more women signing up than men. What's
that about? It's fascinating. For the second year running, about 10 percentage points more women are signing up than men. This year it's about 55% of the enrollees are women, 45% are men. Now, we don't have any reason to believe that more women are uninsured than men, so what explains this? Nobody really knows. People fall back on explanations like, well, women just care more about health and health care sometimes, so they are the primary buyers of health care for their families. Maybe that explains
more it. More conscientious?
Well, and what we also see, interestingly, is of people who got covered last year who actually used their coverage, the signs are the people who used their coverage were older women with chronic illness. So these were women who really needed coverage, and they're using it. They're using it to get care for conditions that they have.
Now, Mary Agnes, you looked especially at Latinos and how the sign-up is going among that group. What did you find?
It's improving. I mean, this is a key demographic for the health law. They tend to be younger and healthier. These are people you want in the risk pool. And the Department of Health and Human Services decided to devote a third of its media budget this year to Latino outreach and enrollment versus 10% last year. But it's still kind of a rough road for a variety of reasons. Like many people who haven't had health insurance before, many Latinos are confused about the process. They're trying to work their way through deductibles and co-pays and premiums and so on. Many people I spoke with who are uninsured now, Latinos, said in the past, we just paid cash. So even with a premium subsidy, they're wondering whether it's worth their while, in some cases, to enroll. But they're definitely the focus of outreach and enrollment. There are many events across the country focused on this demographic group.
So you mentioned the subsidy. And, you know, hanging out there is the realization, and you both talked to us about this, that the tax penalty is there for people who don't sign up, Susan. It's going up. That's on the one hand. On the other hand, we're looking at the prospect of the Supreme Court looking at a case which could end up with these subsidies that Mary Agnes just mentioned being declared unconstitutional.
Well,
so how are the experts?
Well, people are focusing on the fact that the penalties do go up, as you said, for there are different ways to calculate the penalty, but more or less the penalties for not having coverage in 2015 are 2 to 3 times higher than they were the first year round. For example, one level of calculating it, individual penalty went from $95 in 2014 to $325 in 2015, so dramatic jump. So there is that issue. We will get next month, the Supreme Court will hear arguments on the case King versus Burwell that you're alluding to. And in fact, that is going to have the court look at this issue of whether subsidies that go to help purchase coverage apply only to coverage purchased through the state-based exchanges,
right,
or through all the exchanges, including the federal ones.
So just quickly, Mary Agnes, creating kind of a push-pull going on here. Sign up because you'll be penalized if you don't. On the other hand, the whole thing could change.
Right, and the thing about this is a lot of people won't even know about the penalty until they go to file their taxes if they haven't paid attention to the Affordable Care Act and enrollment. I talked to people recently who were saying they didn't even realize that there was this mandate to purchase coverage until they went to sign up for their taxes.
Well, it's fascinating. One more check in, and I know we're going to be talking to both of you again. Mary Agnes Carey, Susan Dentzer, thank you.
Thanks, Judy.
You.